over the past decade, you know, the costs have steadily increased. And if you look at the pricing deltas, they really have not changed very much. And they've been stuck in kind of this yesteryear pricing because of fear that guests will somehow revolt. But it's gotten to the point where these businesses are either going to break and go away, which many have, or they're going to step into this kind of new millennia of pricing and recognize that everything is more expensive. Labor is more expensive. Healthcare is more expensive. The cost of goods are more expensive. Real estate is more expensive. And businesses are running at a very small profitability, if any. And, you know, it took a national or a global emergency to stop our industry and make everybody stop and think like, well, do I really even want to go back to what it was before this? Base cost of everything that we're, or sorry, the base price of almost everything that we're serving has gone up incrementally. And the way that we view that is based on the cost of goods sold, right? Like a very simple, you know, way of adjusting that. And, you know, whereas before in history, right, like any of us who have worked in the restaurant industry for long enough, it's been like this classic thing of, you know, your food cost should be 30%, your labor cost should be 30%, and everything else should be fit into about 20% left, which, you know, should leave you with a healthy 20% margin for the operator, right? And that's been the classic thing, but that's not been the case in California for a very long time. Right now, what you're looking at is for most people's pricing, you know, with labor, all inclusive of benefits, healthcare, management, all those things, sometimes you're seeing restaurants get up to about 48 to 50%. Some are even traveling up to 52%, right?
Labor cost,
labor cost alone. Right. And so what do we take away from, right? Well, you know, a lot of people have said, okay, well, I can't get away from that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to decrease my cost of goods sold. Now, the only way you can decrease your cost of goods sold is two ways. Either you decrease your spend or you decrease the percentage, right? And the only way to decrease the spend is to get lesser quality products. The only way to decrease the percentage is either to get lesser quality products or to raise your prices, right? For us, our integrity is such in terms of our product that we refuse to get a lesser quality product. We have developed over a long period of time the relationships with the vendors and the farmers and the small producers that we've been working with, and we believe in their product, and we also believe in their business model, right? It's not just about a product, right? They also employ people. And they also have different locales, which are less, which are more expensive maybe than doing business with maybe a farm that is growing things for you in Peru, right? And getting that stuff shipped up here. And so that's the most simple way, right? Is raising the costs, raising the prices on your individual menu items. Now, I think anybody that you talk to will tell you that there's a certain price elasticity there, and getting to a place where, you know, at some point guests are unable to comprehend why let's say a burger and fries at their favorite local restaurant, right? I'm not talking about a chain, their favorite local restaurant that bakes their own bun or uses a local bakery that grinds their own meat with meat that's local, that gets like an heirloom tomato and nice cheese and cuts the French fries and all of that stuff. They would be unable to fathom why that restaurant needs to charge $45 for a burger and fries, which should be actually the all-in cost of that in San Francisco to run a successful business.
Right.
So what we've looked at is like, okay, how do we make this more transparent to the guest as to what they're actually paying for? Now, you have a number of different business models, right? But I'll break down like the two most common ones that everyone knows about, which is like dining in or taking food to go, right? Now, over the last year, you've seen a lot of restaurants pivot and open up that revenue stream that maybe didn't exist to them before of doing to-go food. And some will keep that because they found that it's actually more profitable for them to utilize their square footage that way. And some will get rid of it because they would rather go to this brick and mortar, you dine in model, right? But the other thing that's become apparent to all of these restaurants is the fact that the two models are different. And the two costs are different, right? Like you have different technology costs, you have different disposable costs when you're doing to-go food, you have different labor costs and your rent structure and the way your square footage is used inside your restaurant is a different cost when people dine within. And then so we here in the Bay Area, and I know that this is kind of transferred to other parts of California, have had this thing on the bottom of a lot of checks over the past, I'd say 10 years, which started as what we called a healthy SF tax, right? And that was to offset the cost of healthcare,
of the benefits, right?
And that has morphed recently into what people started calling an SF mandate. And the SF mandate is a more ambiguous term that allows restaurants to utilize that money in any way they need to, right? They can use it on labor, they can use it on cost of goods sold, they can use it on rent, and they can also use it for profitability purposes.
Isn't that prevented by legislation though? I thought that was limited.
No,
you can do that now?
Not in California. In California, that's not limited by legislation. You are allowed to have a surcharge for whatever you deem necessary to run your business. Ah. Now, the thing is, that's become a little bit murky. And I'm not saying that in a nefarious way, right? Like, I don't think there's a single restaurant in San Francisco that can use that fee in this twisted way. The truth is, they're just trying to figure out the only way to keep their doors open, right? Right. And so they're not trying to, like, trick the guest. What they're just saying is, like, this is a mandate of how much it costs to do business in SF, right? And that's just clearly that. But we felt like the writing, for example, a dining in charge, right? And making that a specific price that we've calculated is the cost, the difference of what it costs for a guest to whether order food to go or to take that food and dine within our four walls. And so what is that delta actually paying for, right? You're taking up real estate, which is like a table and chairs, our reservation system, a server, a food runner, a busser, a expediter, the ware washer who washes your dishes when you're done, the breakage of those dishes. So for example, for every 10 times one plate gets used, it gets chipped or broken, right? So we have to buy new stuff. The chemicals it takes to wash a table, PPE that we may need to use, I'll give you an example that a lot of people don't even think of, right? Like think about a candle on your table or a votive, right? Those things are not inexpensive. They're not free. Every right. time you go to the restroom, if you use a napkin, every time you go to the restaurant and you flush the toilet, all of those things cost the operator money for you to dine within those four walls. So what we felt like was a much more transparent way of working with our guests is if you're going to dine within our four walls, this is the cost of that delta. Now, if you're going to get food to go, there will be a different charge and it's not going to be the same amount, but it's going to be the amount, the true amount of what it costs for us to put disposables out there. So all of the things that we need to package your food into, it's going to be the cost of the technology that we need to use in order for you to have ordered and all of those different things, right? And also it may even include like credit card processing fees, which a lot of people don't realize that we've gone to a place where maybe 20 years ago, people were still using more cash than anything else. Whereas today, we probably only take in about 3% of all of our total sales, maybe 5%, maybe 2% of all of our total sales in cash. Now, every time you use a credit card at a restaurant, there's a 3.5% processing fee that the restaurant absorbs. Now, that all goes from their profitability. Now, every other business, every other industry in the United States has figured out the fact that they need to pass on their cost to the client, to the consumer, in order for them to run a business. And the biggest lagging indicator of all of this has been the food business, because we have tried to figure out how to make food so cheap. And frankly, it's part of the reason why our country has become sick and why food has started to poison people, right? Because we've over-modified, we've over-streamlined. And it's also, frankly, why this industry, although it employs more people than almost any other industry in the United States, why it is actually not a high earner for a lot of people, because we don't pay people enough.
Right.
And there will be growing pains over the next 5 to 10 years where the consumer and the guest are just going to have to get used to the fact that this business and this industry has to change and has to grow. We also need to reevaluate how we're valuing the folks that work within our restaurants and making sure that they're not burning out, and that we're paying them a fair wage for where they live and where they should live to work in the restaurant. And that, you know, if you are, by the way, if you're voting for these things and you're voting for healthcare and you're voting for higher wages, then you should be proud of going to these restaurants and spending your money there. I think prices in restaurants need to go up across the board throughout the entire industry. I think that if we want to retain better members of our teams, we should be paying more across our industry. Because look, at the end of the day, the proof is in the pudding. Who are you attracting at this pay scale versus this pay scale, right? Right. And if we want to attract more professionals and people who view this as a long-term career path, we should start paying them more, giving them better upward mobility and paths to partnership and all of those different things, and better benefits and better retirement plans and better maternity leave and paternity leave and all of these different things. But I don't want to put a number to it, because here in San Francisco, that number is going to be way different than what the number is going to be in one of those other markets.
Be sure to check out more independent restaurant news content at restaurant-hospitality.com.